Okay, so we are very happy to have Eric Tony from CISA, and he will present talk on entanglement Hamiltonians in one-dimensional quantum system. Welcome, Eric, and now I will hand it over to you to start your talk.
Okay, thank you. First of all, I cannot see all my screen, but. Anyway, it's in, can you see the entire slide or?
Yes, I can. We can see the entire slide.
Okay, maybe. Okay, let's go ahead. Okay, thanks a lot. I want to thank, first of all, Arpan, Anida, and Shubo for setting up this. A nice workshop, giving me the opportunity to present this work. So this is a work I've been doing with this great collaborator for the last few years. You see, so we had some paper on this. So first of all, I want to thank my collaborator that that helped me in getting all these results. So first of all, John Carty from Berkeley, then Vic. Ingo Peschel from Berlin, Victor Eisler from Graz University, and then Raul Arias, who is a postdoc in CISA, and Giuseppe Di Giulio is a PhD student that I'm supervising. Then Luca Tagliacozzo from Barcelona University, and is a PhD student, Jacopo Surace, who is now a postdoc at ICFO, always in Barcelona. So the work I will discuss is based on this series of papers, so I will just sketch the result in order to be an overview of this topic, so this entanglement in one-dimensional quantum system. The idea is that basically I think we all of us agree that now understanding entanglement during the last few decades has become an effort that involved basically three communities of people from quantum information, people from condensed matter, people from quantum gravity, and there are various topics related, if you want, all of them converge in understanding various aspects of entanglement, which is the big question that is in the middle. And so each corner provides different viewpoint on the topic. So because different things are involved, then different regimes, different models can be studied. So it's important that all the community interact. And this workshop in this sense is a nice attempt in going in this direction. So this talk is a little spot, little point more or less in this corner of this triangle, because in the end it's an attempt to show how QFT result and how lattice model result, very simple lattice model, actually mainly free lattice model, can talk. So different techniques from quantum field theory and lattice model somehow converge to provide some information about entanglement. So I think everybody in the audience has seen the definition of entanglement entropy, but let me just give you few lines. So I will consider a spatial bipartition, of the system, which correspond to the factorization in the Hilbert space, and the main object that I will consider is the so-called reduced density matrix, which is the operator that one obtains by tracing out part of the Hilbert space, the B part of the Hilbert space. The normalization is set to one. And actually, because of the properties of this operator, of this reduced density matrix, this can be written can be written as an exponential of another operator, which is what is called entangled Hamiltonian or modular Hamiltonian. So fortunately, many other speakers before me nicely introduced this topic. So this operator. So I will much easier for me to discuss. But actually, the other object I will consider is the spectrum of this operator. And then these two quantities are more fundamental with respect to the very famous entanglement entropy, because actually the entanglement is the von Neumann entropy associated to the reduced density matrix. So it's a number that can be constructed from the eigenvalues, the reduced density matrix. So in some sense, it contains less information with respect to entanglement spectrum and with respect to entanglement Hamiltonian. But there are more techniques to compute it. So if you want, we lose on the side of information. Compute focusing on entanglement Hamiltonians or entanglement spectrum. Somehow one loses on the computability, because there are because it's related to compute entanglement Hamiltonian entanglement spectra, but in, you gain in quantity of information that you get. So I hope that at the end of this talk you will be convinced about this fact. So the outline is basically the following. So the this talk is split in three parts. So the first part is about entanglement Hamiltonian in 2D CFT, and is based on this paper from 2016, and then about the continuum limit on how to get this QFT result from the lattice continuum limit in the proper way. Then I will briefly discuss how this entanglement Hamiltonian can be exploited to evaluate circuit complexity of mixed states. And then in the last part of the talk, I will discuss an out of equilibrium situation, which involves the global quantum quenches for various models. So the first part, let me start with a very basic, very important result by Bisognano and Wickman, who found that for any quantum field theory in the ground state, when the space is separated, is split into two parts, left and right. Unfortunately, I don't understand why there's no pointer here, but if the system is split into two parts, so the A part is exactly half space, so x1 is the spatial direction parametrizing this half space, then Bisognano and Wickman found that the entangled Hamiltonian is the correspond to the generator of the Lorentz boost, that points into the positive direction of x1. And explicitly, the operator is written as is written there. So it's an integral over A. A is the red part in the picture. So it's on the half space of x1 time t00. t00 is the time component of the stress tensor, and x1 is the distance from the boundary. It's important that in this case the boundary that separate A from B is really a straight hyperplane, so it's not the form. So this fundamental result holds for when the space is really split into two parts. Well, Bisognano and Wickman result holds for any two field theory. It is done unitary variance, so it holds for massive theory. So one can instead, if one is interested in conformal field theories, one can use conformal invariance to explore a different situation. particular what Hislop and Longo and then Cassini, Huerta, Myers analyzed is the case of a ball of reduced R in generic dimension. And exploiting the conformal invariance of the underlying model, they found that in this case, the entangled Hamiltonian of a ball of radius R can be written as an integral over the ball of the, again, the time-time component of the stress tensor, T00, multiplied by a weight functions, which is this parabola here, R squared here, multiplying T00 inside the integral. And in this talk, we will be mostly interested into the simplest case, which is the two-dimensional case, 1+1, conformal effective in two dimensions, where the subregion is an interval. In the case where the theory in the ground state, that then this result simply gives you this parabola, x times L minus x, where L is the size of the interval. Okay, good. So the first thing that I want to discuss is this approach based on the Euclidean field theory, where the reduced density matrix can be seen discussed by considering the bipartition between A and B in the complex plane parameterized by Z, where A is this red part between the two endpoints and B is the remaining part. And actually the bipartition is identified by these black circles, by this black circle. Actually, this kind of regularization has been also discussed first, I think it's in the original seminal paper by Wilczek, Olsey, and Larsen in 94. So it's really something from the very beginning of this kind of calculation. The idea of this paper with John Card is the fact that actually this the plane, the complex plane, where these two little disks around the black, these little disks around the endpoints are exceeded, can be mapped into an annulus by a conformal transformation. The annulus parameterized by a complex coordinate W. And then basically in this mapping, one can extract a lot of information. In particular, one can write the Rényi entropies or the N moment reduced density matrix as a partition function, as a ratio between the partition function of an nth annulus normalized by the partition function of the annulus to the N, because when little n is equal to 1, these numbers must be equal to 1. Actually, the nth annulus correspond to the annulus obtained by cutting the cylinder along the red line. Unfortunately, I don't have the pointer, so I cannot. But anyway, you have to imagine to cut the cylinder along the red line, then take n copy of these. Of these this rectangle, then attach them simply, and opening in this way an annulus whose circumference here is not 2 pi but 2 pi n. Okay, this is what we call an annulus here. And well, this is another way to write the Rényi entropies in this case, that allows you to write the Rényi entropy in this way, as an expansion in W. W is the width of this capital W, the width of this cylinder, which is very large, because the little disks that are exceeded around the endpoints are very small. They are the radius is order of the UV cutoff. So this is an expansion in the UV cutoff. And in this expansion, it's possible to realize that the leading term is governed by the width of the cylinder, of this annulus, actually. And in the subleading pieces, then all the boundary contribution due to the Affle-Dugdy boundary entropy, the boundary state associated to these black circles, enter into the game. Another result that one can obtain from this mapping to the annulus picture is modular Hamiltonian, because one can consider the energy on the loose, which is given by this integral here, the integral constant V in the W, in the complex plane parameterized by W, and then mapping back to the complex plane, one can write in general the entanglement Hamiltonian in the complex plane parameterized by Z in this form. So as a sum of two integrals, where T and T bar are the usual and the usual holomorphic anti-holomorphic operator that are that we know from 2D CFTs, and F of Z is the conformal mapping that relates the two picture, the complex plane parameterized by Z to the annulus parameterized by W. In the simpler cases of a time independent configuration, actually these two integral collapse into the same integral, and then an integral on the interval or on the subregion, the interval A is an interval in this case, and the weight function is given by the inverse of the derivative of this conformal mapping. Okay, so this is the result. Then another outcome of this analysis is about the entanglement spectrum, because one can write an expansion of the entanglement, lambda j is the generic eigenvalues, and one can see that this log of lambda j can be expanded in the UV cutoff in this way, where WA is is the same W in the previous slides. So W is the leading piece, and then there is a constant term that contains the Alfred-Ludwig boundary entropies. But then, interestingly, in the subleading piece, you can read also the conformal dimension of the underlying CFT, which is a boundary CFT in this case. And it's immediate from this expression to observe that if you consider the gaps, so GR here is the difference between log of lambda R and the first and log of lambda one, it's immediate to realize that the ratio of if you consider this ratio of gaps, GR over G1, you see that if you refine it, so you select this delta j. So it's important that these delta j are not the primaries, but they contain also central. This is the prediction from the CFT analysis. And then let me give you the simplest example. The simplest example is the ground state, the interval on the line. A is an interval, the system is in the ground state, and here you see on the left there is the complex plane, you cut two little disks around the endpoints, and then you can, in this case F is this simple map here, then W on the right is the cylinder, where is this rectangle where you have to identify the two horizontal edges. And W is the width of this if you specify the previous expression to this case, it's immediate to realize this F prime gives you exactly the parabola that you expect, and then also the Reni entropies are the one that at least the leading piece is the one that is expected from previous calculation based on twist field. And you see that W here is a log of L over epsilon. So it's divergent when epsilon goes to zero. Another cases that can be studied using this approach is the case of a finite volume. So in this case, this entire system is in the ground state. The subsystem is again an interval, and the system now it's not on the line, but it's on a spatial, on a circle. So periodic boundary condition, and capital L is the total volume, the volume of the the length of the total circle, and 2r is the size of the interval. In this case, the holomorphic function is the one written on the top right here, and the entangled Hamiltonian has always the form. So T00 integral over the interval of T00 multiplied by the weight function, which in this case is more complicated because it involves also the volume, the final volume of the entire system. Another interesting case that can be studied from this approach is this is the case of a finite interval on the line, but at finite temperature, it's very similar to the previous one. If you see the function, the holomorphic function, very similar to the previous one, but physically it's a different thing. But the final result is similar. It involves the hyperbolic sign instead of the normal sign, and beta is the inverse temperature. Okay, then another case, interesting case that I want to consider and that can be studied from this approach is the case of an interval attached to the boundary. In this case, so you see A now is an interval of length R, and one endpoint is one endpoint of is really on the boundary. So in the left panel, the vertical line in the Euclidean picture corresponds to the physical boundary of this. And now A and B, so the two subregions are separated by one single endpoint. In the twist field picture, this would correspond to a one-point function of the twist field, but now we are considering this. And now this can be studied through this annulus approach, and the interesting difference with respect to the previous case is that now the two boundaries that are involved are physically very different, because one boundary is originated from the regularization procedure. So when you cut out a little disk around the endpoint of the interval, and the other boundary is the black curve that corresponds to the physical boundary. So now the boundary terms that enter in this formula are very different, because they are associated to different boundaries, and in particular one of them, the one associated to the physical boundary condition, is determined by the boundary condition that you impose from the very beginning. This fact is very important, because if you think the boundary condition responding to the black line is the one that you impose from the very beginning when you define the model. So when you define the model, you impose a physical boundary condition, and that fixes one of these two G, one of these two boundary entries. But the other one, the one associated to the cutting procedure, it's not obvious, it's not clear what it corresponds to, because from this conformal analysis, it's only important that it corresponds to the conformal boundary state, but which one, it's a question that is not clear from this analysis. And this question allows me to connect to the second part of this first part, because that's where, if you want, some lattice calculation comes in, okay? So in the following slide, I will try to understand how it's possible to show you how it's possible to reproduce the simple QFT result that I have discussed in the simplest situation, so an interval in the ground state, but using lattice technique. So in particular, let me consider a very simple lattice model, which is an harmonic chain with periodic boundary condition. So here you see you have the P operator that satisfies canonical boundary condition. Actually, this is a free model. It's quadratic. So it's well known that all the important information using Gaussianity and weak theorem, it's encoded into the two-point functions. Two-point functions of Q of the momentum and position operator. So this two-point function can be arranged into what is called covariance matrix, which is called gamma. And in particular, when you, it's well known from the 90s, from the paper of very old paper, the first lattice calculation of entanglement due to the due to Bombelli, Sorkin, also Peschel, Zrenicki in the 90s, known how to compute entanglement entropy. In this case, you have to construct the two-point function and then of the entire system, and then reduce them to the subsystem that you are interested in. As for the entangled Hamiltonian, which is the operator we want to consider, the idea is the same, but that thanks to the result of Peschel, Cassini, Huerta, and also more recently by Banchi, Brownstein, and Pirandola, one can write the entangled Hamiltonian in this as a quadratic operator of this form K, where the important object is this matrix HA, which is a positive and symmetric matrix that can be written in terms of the two-point function reduced, the so-called reduced covariance matrix, which is nothing else than the covariance matrix or the two-point function, the correlation matrix reduced to the subsystem. So that's the beauty of this model. The simplicity of this model is that if you know the two-point function, you know you can construct formally also the entanglement. This is for the bosonic, but also for fermionic, for free fermions, the idea is the same, and the main result have been mostly obtained by Peschel, who found this nice expression for the entanglement Hamiltonian matrix, if you want, this T, which is related to the correlation matrix CA, restricted to the subsystem. In this case, it's an interval, so the indices I and j goes from 1 to little n. So if you want, in the following slide, I will try to explore the relation between what are these matrices. So if you want, we can call it entanglement Hamiltonian matrices, H, A, and T. Okay, because the thing is that the relation between these entangled Hamiltonian matrices and the reduced correlation matrices is only not three, and in this relation is a lot of interesting physics is encoded. So, first of all, if one is interested in quantum field theory, one can ask, okay, I have this nice lattice result in the top left on the slide, which is a Hamiltonian written in a lattice form in terms of this matrix, Tij, and I know the corresponding QFT result as an integral of some weight function beta of x time t00. Can I see on the lattice, can I take the continuum limit, how the continuum limit works? This is something that it's a first lesson theory in Hamiltonian, for the physical Hamiltonian, this is how the Klein-Gödel field is usually introduced, but here we are considering the entangled Hamiltonian, so it's one can ask, is it the same? What's the difference? In particular, the QFT result is very different. So it's interesting to ask how does the continuum limit work. And here there are some interesting surprises in the sense that as I will try to illustrate. So let us consider simple cases given by the Dirac fermion and the interval and a single where beta is this parabola. For Dirac fermion, T00 is written in this form in terms of the left and right component of the of the field. And actually, there is a nice analysis, beautiful analysis by Casini, Huerta, Arias, and Blanco a few years ago, based on the discretization of delta, basically starting from the continuum expression and discretizing the delta. Actually, here I will, in the next slide, I will explain a kind of complementary approach based more based on the lattice. On the lattice result, mostly obtained by Esler and Pesce. The idea is the following. So in a few years ago, Esler and Pesce, in a very nice paper, they made the following observation. They have considered the free fermion chain and the interval in the ground state, and they studied this ratio, so this matrix, Tij, over n, and capital N is the number of sites in the interval. And then they observe that, well, if you take this matrix, Tij, it is not localized on the diagonal, or on the first diagonal, but there are many diagonals involved whose amplitude decreases as the distance from the main diagonal increase. In particular, you see from these pictures, so the red dots correspond to the first diagonal, the blue to the third diagonal, the black to the fifth diagonal, and for n equal 40 site, so the system contains, it's in the thermodynamics, so it's on the infinite line, so you select 40 site and then you compute that. Actually, they observe that if you take the first diagonal, this little h, you see that all the lattice data collapse on the red curve as you increase n. So if you go into the thermodynamic limit, when the number of sites in the interval goes to infinity, the first diagonal converts to this red curve, the third diagonal compared to this other red curve. Look at the size. If you go from the first to the third, there is a factor of 10, 1/10 between the two. So the amplitude decrease, but they are still non-zero. So the nice analysis that they were able to find analytic expression for these red curves in terms of hypergeometric function. So you see that for the P diagonal, they were able to write this analytic expression, which perfectly fits with the lattice data. So now there is a question.
Sorry, Eric, question.
Yeah.
TIJs, what were they initially? I mean, I thought they were just the couplings between the fermions. Or...
Let me go back. So T... Ij is this matrix here. So yeah. If you want, is the coupling. Yeah. So the thing is that you first compute the two-point function, mm-hmm. which is C. Then you reduce the two-point function on the subsystem, which is an interval. Then you invert. Then you subtract one, and then you take the log. Okay. So this procedure provides you, so you are still working with a quadratic operator in terms of the fermionic operator CI, but the new matrix T you are dealing with is highly non-trivial. Mm-hmm. And that's the interesting part, because it's not translation invariant anymore, for instance, because the initial system is translation invariant. CA depend on just on the distance between the two sites, but TIJ is not.
But TIJ, roughly speaking, can be thought of as how coupled the ith oscillator is with the jth oscillator, or
exactly, yeah, exactly. It's a kind of long range coupling.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So this for P in this expression for P corresponds to nearest Eisler and Peschel fun is that okay, also the third there are longer long range interaction in both coupling in both. So this was from the lattice point of view. What we did is to take carefully the continuum limit in the standard way, if you want, and I will skip all the details, but the final result is that if you now take the con limit in a standard, so you introduce the UV cutoff, you introduce the field in terms of the operator in the standard way, so it's really one can obtain this result from the field theory point of view. So the entanglement Hamiltonian can be written as a sum of operator where H plus and H minus are a field. So K correspond to the K derivative because K, you see that psi with the K on the top correspond to the K derivative. And then the F plus and F minus are weight functions written in terms of this hypergeometric function that I wrote before. So S is the UV cutoff. So complicated, but you have to think that this is an expansion in the UV cutoff. So if you send the UV cutoff to zero, only the first few terms survive. And if you look at them carefully, M equals zero term in this expansion are zero. And then M equal one term is exactly what you expect conformal field theory calculation. The higher order term, which involve higher order derivatives, are suppressed, goes to zero as the UV cutoff goes to zero. Okay, so this is it's a derivation of an expected result, but what is interesting, in my opinion, is the procedure. Is the procedure from the lab to the quantum field theory result, which is interesting because actually it can be done at least in this simple model. Because if one then try to go try to complicate a little bit the situation. For instance, one can ask what happens in the finite volume case. In the finite volume case, for instance, one can again compute the numerically the matrix T, if you want, and then which correspond to this capital H, and then construct the combination that provides the beta of X, so the weight function that enter in the quantum field theory entangled Hamiltonian. And actually it turns out that numerically is the idea works in the sense that one has to consider the proper linear combination between the diagonals. You see here P is the diagonal, so and I correspond to the index along the diagonal. And you see from this picture that if you increase the number as you consider more and more diagonal, you approach the CFT result. It works both for the periodic chain and both for the infinite chain at finite temperature. Okay, so but the point is that here we can check numerically that the idea works, but we don't have all the analytic steps in between, the one involving the hypergeometric, etc.
But can't you add a mass term, Eric? You can't add a mass term and do the same calculation?
The mass term?
Yeah,
the mass term, but you don't have the CFT result.
That's true, but shouldn't it be easy enough to add a mass term and take the mass going to zero limit in some sense? I mean, that gives you an extra parameter.
Now, if you add the mass term in the lattice, it's another story. Unfortunately, I don't have time to discuss that, but it's really, put the mass from the very beginning, then you have to keep it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, if you want, this is something that you see from CFT you can deal with. You have a prediction from CFT, also the correlator, everything is there. It's just the step in between that that are missed, but that are still missing. But if you want, it's a technical thing. But you see, numerically, it works. The point is that if you do the same calculation in the massive theory, you can do it on the lattice, but you don't know what is the red curve.
I see. Okay.
Thank okay. You. Then, yeah. Sorry. Then the same idea can be applied for the harmonic chain. Here is slightly more complicated because the entangled Hamilton can be split into two parts. One associates the momentum. There are two matrices to deal with. I want to be quick on that because the idea is the same. So H is written in this form. It's a complicated expression discussed by Cassini and Huerta in terms of the QA and PA, which are the two-point function of the position and the moment are restricted to the interval. And again, one can apply the same idea to push forward by Esler and Peschel and take this first the limit of the K diagonal. And you see here are you see the main diagonal, the red curve is the CFT parabola. You see the data collapse on some curve, which is CFT, also for the two set of matrices. And the question is how to combine this curve to provide a parabola. And again, okay, I will skip the details, but you go through you take the continuum limit in a standard way. So as you see, you have to introduce the UV cutoff A. So Q goes to the field phi and P goes to the field pi. The point is that you have to deal with the long range interactions. And so the result is that now you have to change a little bit the combination because you see now you have to consider combination involving K square instead of K. And just to give you the final result, this is the result for an interval in the infinite line. You can write this operator as an expansion in the UV cutoff A. And there is a divergent term, as you see, 1 over A square. But the point is that if you look at this weight function, M0 and M2, they are zero. They are zero. So fine. And the final piece, which is provide N0 and M2, provide exactly the parabola that you want. And this is given by these two panels that I cannot indicate because I don't have the pointer. But you see, and the data collapse beautifully. Okay, there are numerical issues related to the precision to work with, but at least you see that the expected parabola is nicely reproduced once you consider this long range and the proper combination of diagonals. So if you want, the lesson is that getting the parabola, which is kind of easily obtained in the quantum field theory approach, is highly non-trivial if you start from the lattice point of view. And then also you can play also with the boundary. So here we consider an interval in the semi-infinite line. You play the same game. Now instead of the parabola, you get half of the parabola. There we consider Dirichlet boundary condition and okay, there are the idea is the same. Actually, the next step, the next thing to consider is the spectrum, because as I discussed at the beginning, one has the spectrum of this operator, one can consider the entanglement spectrum, and if you want the very important paper, in my opinion, is the one by Loughlin, 2013, who made a numerical analysis of the entanglement spectra in the conformal regime for various spin chain. And he first observed that the data that he was obtaining reproduced the conformal spectrum of a boundary conformal field theory. In particular, if you take, for instance, the Ising model, which has central charge equal 1/2, if you look at the central panel, what you observed, the data are the one with the black dots. You see, they correspond to the conformal tower of 0 and 1/2. So you was not observing the conformal tower corresponding to 1/16. And then you observe that this conformal spectrum is correspond to a CFT on an annulus by using a result by Cardi from the 80s. And actually this fit perfectly with the approach that I was discussing at the very beginning. The point is that he was able, looking at this data, to realize which are the boundary conditions associated to the little circles, because you can put the Ising model on the annulus, and there are various allowed conformal boundary conditions that has been studied by Cardi, but not all of them are observed in the numerical calculation. Actually, Locklin realized that the one reproduced correspond to three boundary conditions imposed to both the endpoints. Okay, so last year we repeated this analysis, but for the harmonic chain, considering, for instance, periodic boundary condition or Dirichlet boundary condition. And you see that, first of all, if you consider the ratio of the gaps, GR over G1, so which is a UV finite quantity, as I mentioned at the beginning, according to the conformal field theory prediction, you see that the data collapse on the expected line. You see 1, 2, 3, 4 with different degeneracy. And if you look carefully at the degeneracies, you see that, first of all, you observed the CFT prediction is confirmed, so in this simple model. And secondly, if you compare the two spectra, you see that the data are compatible with free or Neumann boundary condition imposed at the entangling point. And this is why we consider these two different spatial configuration, because if you consider only periodic boundary conditions, so one interval on the circle or on the infinite line, you cannot decide whether there are Dirichlet or Neumann boundary condition. Only by comparing these two, one can we realize that is the Neumann boundary condition which is selected at the entangling point. Okay, so this is the end of this first part. And there are no questions. I will move to the part related to complexity. I will skip all the introduction by complexity because you have heard a lot of nice talk by expert, actually real expert on complexity. I just want to give you just to tell you how this idea of entangled Hamiltonian can be related to complexity. Of course, now one has to consider complexity of mixed state because the idea is that entangled Hamiltonians characterize reduced density matrices which are mixed states. So then the question is related to the circuit complexity that involves mixed states. So in the simple setting of bosonic Gaussian state, one can work with covariance matrices, as I have discussed before. And so one can consider circuits made by covariance matrices. Okay, in this case, a possibility is to introduce a Fischer-Rao distance in the space of the symmetric and positive definite matrices. And then in this case, the length of a path is given by this. And actually there is a nice mathematical result that tells you, which is known from mathematician, that tells you that in this space, there is a geodesic connecting two two covariance matrices, and these geodesics can be written explicitly in this form in terms of the initial point gamma r and the reference, which is the reference state, and the final point, the target state. In this way, S is the parameter along the geodesic that goes from 0 to 1. So for S equals 0, you see that you have the initial reference state, the initial covariance matrix, and then for S equal 1, you get the final gamma t. And the distance, the length of this optimal circuit provides the complexity of this circuit. Of course, this is an optimal situation where the allowed all the matrices, all the covariance matrices are allowed, and so there is no restriction on the gates. So it's really the simplest and the easiest situation one can do, but can work with this analytic expression. And
so
then we check that.
Quick question. So these mixed states are still Gaussian?
Yes.
Okay, I see.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm focusing only on Gaussian state. All the state along the optimal circuit are Gaussians, and actually it can be proven that it's also a covariance matrix.
So these mixed states, are they corresponds to this reduced density matrix that you showed before?
Yeah, exactly. This is, thanks for the question, because the idea is that, okay, since these expressions are written in terms of the covariance matrix, but these are symmetric matrices, okay, symmetric and positive definite matrices. So one can, write the same, one can ask, can I write the same circuit, but using the entangled Hamiltonian matrices? So now, and this is a simple thing, so it's just in the previous slide I discussed this H, and now I consider two reduced density matrices characterized by two H, so HR and HT, so the reference state can be equivalently characterized by its entangled Hamiltonian matrix HR, the target state it's a mixed state is described by its own target entangled Hamiltonian matrix, and then construct formally these optimal circuits in the space of the entangled Hamiltonian matrices. Okay, the point is that the two pictures are related because there is because the matrix H and the covariance matrix gamma are related. So if you want, it's a kind of reparametrization of the two things. So if I know the optimal circuit in terms of the covariance matrices, of course I use this map studied by Casini and Huerta, the same map that I was studying before, right? The one that gives you the parabola from the two-point function. So if you want, it's a kind of reparametrization, but it's not an isometry. So the length of this optimal circuit is different if you consider the entangled Hamiltonian picture or the covariance matrix picture. So of course this looks more complicated because the entangled Hamiltonian are more complicated, but at least from the principal point of view, should be equivalent to consider to express that circuit complexity of entangled or in terms of or covariance matrix, at least for these free models. Of course, if you have interaction, it's much more complicated, but here we are restricting to free models. Okay. Yes, any question? Because then there is the last part related to quenches. So. Okay, I will proceed. So in the last part, I will show you how this idea gives you some interesting feature for in a situation out of equilibrium. So in this case, what is important is, and P situation that has been largely studied during the last decade is the what are called quantum quenches, where basically a system is prepared in the ground state of an Hamiltonian at zero, and then at some point a sudden change is performed in some sense, and the evolution of Hamiltonian is H. So psi naught, the initial state is not an eigenstate of the evolution of Hamiltonian, and the resulting unitary evolution is highly non-trivial. Basically, two class of quenches has been studied, depending on whether translation invariance is preserved or not. For instance, I will focus on global quench, where a global parameter of the Hamiltonian is modified. For instance, if you switch off the mass and then you look at the conformal evolution. And here there is the famous result obtained by Calabresi and Cardi, where for the entanglement entropy that increases linearly and then saturate. Okay, and the coefficient of this linear increase is governed by the central charge. Okay, then they introduce also a nice quasi-particle picture that I don't have time to discuss. But here there is this famous linear increase with time that stops at when t over l is equal to 1/2. And this is related to the quasi-particle picture. I want to mention that the annulus picture that for the entanglement Hamiltonian that I discussed works can be applied also to this case. And in this case, there is a nice feature given by the fact that the two operators cannot be summed anymore, and one has to deal with t and t bar separately. But the linear growth is recovered. And also, if one looks at the gaps of the entanglement spectrum, one observes that the gaps of the entanglement spectrum, so the difference between the first eigenvalue, the second eigenvalue with respect to the first, the third with respect to the first, etc., actually they decrease with time, and the coefficient of these this leading term is governed not by the central charge but by the conformal dimension of the boundary conformal field theory underlying this thing. So this was from the CFT analysis, and now I want to tell you what the lattice tell us. In the prototypical model of the transfer field Ising chain, so in the Ising chain, sigma X and sigma I, these are the usual Pauli matrices, and then there is this eta parametrizes the boundary condition that which is a periodic boundary condition or open boundary condition is eta, and then this theta instead parametrizes the magnetic field. Usually this cot theta is what is usually called H, and the critical point correspond to pi, so theta equal pi over 4. For theta equal pi over 4, the continuum theory is described by the Ising field theory. Actually, in this work done with Luke Tagliacozzo and his student Jacopo Surace, we study numerically the time evolution of the gaps and of the entanglement spectrum after a quench at the critical point. Actually, we study various situations, but I want to show you what happens. So here in this plot, it's a time evolution, you see, in the periodic boundary condition, the subsystem is A of length. And the gray line in the bottom part is a entanglement entropy. You see, is the linear growth and then the saturation. And then since we are in the periodic situation, then there is a decreasing and then a revival. So there is a periodicity when T over L is equal to. But then look instead, the other curve correspond to the eigenvalues of the reduced density matrix. You see there is this linear growth again and then saturation. But what is interesting, look at the splitting of the various eigenvalues and the different degeneracies that happen in the different regime 1, 2, 3 that can be explained in terms of quasi particle. And if you look at the gaps, now actually, if you look at the gaps, the situation is even more interesting because look on the left, we consider periodic boundary condition, on the right, open boundary. And you see that if you consider the inverse of the gap, there is this linear growth, exactly as predicted by in the first regime, as predicted by conformal field theory, and then the saturation. And then if you look at the ratio of the gaps, there is they are constant. And then as the regime changes, they change, but they remain also constant in the other regime, just the degeneracy changes. And there are values that are not seen. Yeah, I don't have time to explain, but it's nice that this picture can be explained using in terms of BCFT and using OPE and the annulus thing, but at least in the first two regimes. But not all the time evolution can be explained analytically. And the observation is that this data, so this number, can be justified. One assume that A, if that free boundary condition are imposed at the regularization point. So I think this is a nice numerical study that that requires more analytical understanding. But this is actually this result can be explained in terms of the boundary CFT, because the evolution is critical. The data here are obtained when theta is equal to pi over 4, which is the Ising CFT evolution. But numerically, the beauty of numerics is that, okay, you can play with the parameter. Even if you don't have the theory, you can see what happens. And here what we did is to consider quench across, to compare quenches across the quantum critical point and quenches within the same phase. So the interesting observation here is that if you look at this, so the inverse gap and the ratio of the gap, there is a qualitative very different behavior when you consider quenches across the critical point, because you see in the intermediate regime you observe the values expected from the conformal evolution. So even though the evolution is not conformal, because but somehow this data, this quantity seems to know something about the fact that you have crossed the critical point. It's because indeed, if you compare the same quantity, when you don't cross, you stay within the same phase, you don't see this nice collapse on 1, 2, 3 short days. And this is something that still is need to be explained from the theoretical point of view. Finally, I want to show you some result about the entanglement. Actually, so this was for the entanglement spectrum, but what about the entanglement Hamiltonian? So I will show you some result for different quenches. So one for harmonic chain, when you switch off the mass parameter from 1 to 0, omega is the mass parameter. And the other case is the case of a free fermionic chain where the initial state is the ground state of the dimerized change, which is whose Hamiltonian is defined in this way. So Tn is 1 or 0. So the coupling is only between two sites. So at t equals 0, you switch off all the Tn at the initial time, and the evolution is, of course, through the usual homogeneous Hamiltonian. So in these cases, the correlators are known. And so here is what happened to the time evolution for the harmonic chain. So when you for an interval of one light, when you shift off the mass, you see the covariance matrix, the entanglement Hamiltonian matrix can be separated in four blocks, because remember, one is correspond to QQ, to the position, one to PP, and the other to the QP. And you see that we observe a highly non-trivial behavior of the matrix, right? Then if you look at the gap or the inverse gap, you still see the same feature that I was showing before for the model, and that is fine. Then this is the case for the free fermionic chain, the real part, because in this case the entanglement Hamiltonian matrix is complex, although its property guarantee the hermeticity. So this is the real part. You see again that as time evolves, there is a kind of band structure, this evolution with time. And then for last time, the Hamiltonian is completely filled, in the sense that is non-vanishing in all this diagonal. And this is the imaginary part of the entanglement Hamiltonian matrix for the free fermionic chain. And then if you look at the width of this band as time evolves, you see that kind of linear growth. So if you compare, it's interesting to compare this is a snapshot of the matrix, entanglement Hamiltonian matrix, and the same matrix for the correlation for the two-point function. You see the difference, right? Because the width is the same, but the main feature that one, the fact that the two-point function is translation invariant in the bottom panel, while the entanglement Hamiltonian matrix is highly inhomogeneous along the diagonal, right? And again, if you look at the inverse gap or the ratio of the gap, again you see the same feature that I was mentioning for the Ising model. Okay, so just to briefly conclude, I have discussed a BCF boundary conformal field theory approach to entanglement Hamiltonian and to entanglement spectrum. I have showed in very simple cases how it works, the continuum limit, taking the continuum limit of lattice result to get the quantum field theory result for the entanglement Hamiltonian, that I have briefly discussed this relation to circuit complexity for mixed state. And finally, I have showed some results about entanglement Hamiltonian and the corresponding spectra for an interval, but after a global quench. Of course, there are many things one can do. One can consider different models, different kind of quenching, going to higher dimension. Of course, there is a big question related to holography that I think many people are expert here. There is a lot to do in the next years, both from the condensed matter side and also from the quantum field theory side and also from quantum information side, which I'm not expert in, but hopefully this kind of workshop will help. Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Eric, for a wonderful talk. So the floor is now open for the questions. So if anyone has some more questions, you can ask. You can ask because
Hi, Eric. You mentioned this relationship between the circuit complexity and the entanglement Hamiltonians. So using these, can one also calculate or study the complexity for these quench models that you described?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. This is something. Yeah, I don't have result on that, but it's certainly an open.
Any more questions?
I have a question about I have a question about what you said at the beginning about the G that appears when you do the cut. So not from the boundary, but from the cut, right? Yeah. So is that a characteristic of a CFT? Because I mean, I would normally not have associated a kind of Affleck-Ludwig entropy to that. What? How do we think of it physically? This the G that comes from the cut.
Yeah, the thing is that so in this approach, one use a BCFT, right? You imagine that cutting in the cutting procedure introduce some boundaries. Yeah, that's the idea. So as soon as you have boundaries, then you have to in this usually boundary CFT approach that that has been
okay. So it's just a choice you have. What value G takes, or it's intrinsic to a given.
Yeah, the thing is that in this approach we don't know, because as long as the boundary state is a conformal boundary state, then it's fine. Then right, take the free theory, that the free boson, for instance. Then we know that you have either Dirichlet or Neumann, basically. Mm-hmm. Roughly. Boundary state. They are both perfectly nice boundary state that they ensure conformal invariance in the presence of boundaries. But in this analysis, they provide different G's in general, because this is all for any CFT. So if you have a different boundary state, you have a different Affleck-Ludwig boundary entropy.
If I compute the Reni entropies just by twist operator insertions, I mean, what G's do they yield?
The point is that this quantity is related in the using the twist field. There is an ambiguity related to the normalization, right? Because what is called usually CN.
Yes.
And that ambiguity in this approach is encoded in this G.
Okay.
So indeed, that if you go through the twist field approach, you see that the ambiguity on CN is in the finite term.
Mm-hmm.
The leading term, the C3 log L, is okay. And also in this approach, the leading piece is reproduced. But the subleading piece is related to the normalization of the twist field. And that's where the regularization procedure enter. And in this approach, it's encoded into the G, the G. So the nice thing of this approach is that it gives you results also for the spectra. And as I was trying to explain, the spectra seem, even in the lattice, are sensible to this boundary condition. That's the my main message, if you want, that somehow the CFT gives you the universal feature, but this non-universal are more not that let's say that somehow the cutting procedure seems to fix the boundary condition in a way that I don't know how to fix from the quantum field theory.
Right. So the cutting procedure is not universal, basically. It's...
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So any more questions? Okay. So if not, we thanks Eric for a wonderful talk.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, so this formally starts the discussion sessions. I don't know how many of the speakers are still around. Probably Fook is still around.
Yeah, I'm still around.
And the other speakers, let's see who else is around.
Frame is around.
Frame is around, and Gaurav is around.